STEMI, about identifying EKGs and what location of the heart is involved, which is, and based on that, based on the EKGs, likely what artery is involved. Let me ask you, you know, the heart has four chambers, right? Which chamber are we, is all this discussion based on? And the options would be the right ventricle, the right atrium, the left atrium, or the right ventricle. What's that?
Left.
Well, I heard, go ahead, just spit it out. It doesn't
look, is there all of the above? Is that...
In general, I would say 90% of what we talk about is the left ventricle. It's true the right ventricle can be involved, but most of the discussion, everything that we're regarding STEMI, it mostly involves the left ventricle. The reason for that is that the left ventricle is what's providing the circulation to your whole body. It's providing the pump to the systemic circulation. And when that's impaired, the consequences of that can be all the way from heart failure to shock, as well as when there's a huge area of muscle that's not getting blood supply, which is called ischemia, we can have arrhythmic events that can be catastrophic. In fact, 1/3 of heart attacks that STEMI patients die before they ever get to the hospital, and the majority of those occur because of sudden death. And what do I gotta press? Just enter?
Try the arrow.
Space.
I don't know what to do without you. Okay. So heart disease is the number one killer. You've probably all heard that before, but let's keep this in mind. In our age group, because some of you are quite young, this is literally number one. There is nothing that exceeds it. Homicide certainly doesn't exceed it. Burning doesn't exceed it. Cancer doesn't exceed it. We have nothing. Infectious diseases, influenza, this is the one. And the prevalence of it is incredible, right? By the time you're in your 70s and 80s, 1 out of every 3 women are going to suffer from this. You've probably all heard the statistic, 1 in every 8 women will suffer from breast cancer. Think about that. 1 in every 3 may experience this, and 1 in every 2 men as they enter their older age. The presence of any risk factors associated with doubling the risk of MI, and these are, why are these called non-modifiable risks?
You can't do anything about it.
Sure, unfortunately, you're stuck with your family and your brother Lester, you're stuck with your gender. I guess in this age, you're not necessarily stuck with your gender and your age.
Not that home for you.
And then you have these modifiable risk factors, which include smoking, diabetic control, hypertension, hyperlipidemia, obesity, and physical inactivity. So it's our obligation to try and modify these risk factors, because the other ones we don't have much to do with. There's just my picture of people doing what they're not supposed to do. Probably of the ones that are modifiable, this is the one that's probably the greatest that you got to keep in mind. Tobacco use increases the risk of coronary disease probably more on the 6 times. Why it does it, there's a bunch of reasons. But it stimulates, it damages the vessel wall, it causes the release of about a bunch of vasoconstrictors. So it's the worst thing in the world. And I'll tell you, what's even worse is after we do a PCI, if they continue to smoke, that's even, if we open a vessel and put a stent, they got to stop at least for 6 weeks, because that vessel wall, you don't want it irritated where that stent is. Does anyone know really what's the general principle of what happens during a STEMI? If we went down to the level of the artery, does anyone understand that?
Occlusion.
And how does it
build up? Inflammation.
Right. And
occlusion.
So the traditional theory and the way we all used to think of STEMI and acute heart attacks is that you would have this vessel that began to develop a plaque, and the plaque would progress over prolonged periods of time, and then at some point it would completely occlude. Is that sort of your understanding or what you thought happens?
Yes.
So it turns out that's not what we think. The majority of STEMIs occur in a different situation. When you look at the research and they do autopsies, they find that greater than 50% of the heart attacks that do happen, once they take the clot out, you unplug the clot, you look at what was the lumen size before, if I take this clot out, more than 50% of those lesions were less than 50% narrow before the clot, once you take the clot out. And you're like, well, that doesn't make sense to me. And so what it has to do with is the actual vessel wall. The stuff under the vessel, there's a thin layer of cells called the endothelium that cover the actual innermost part of the lumen of the vessel. It has a lot of lubricants and other things that keep the vessel well and keep things from getting in. Once that's disrupted, underneath there is where the plaque is. If that endothelium is disrupted in any way, the stuff underneath it, the subendothelial stuff, is extremely clot prone. So if you disrupt that in some way, the clot will start to form and then it'll occupy the host space. What are the things that make the that endothelium be disrupted? This is what we talk about, vulnerable plaques and plaque erosions. But the basic premise though is that most of the thing that causes the heart attacks are the ones that are unstable plaques. The ones that are actually tighter, those are more stable. They will cause angina when you're walking around, but they're not. It's less likely to rupture and have a clot form on top of it. What is the difference between a STEMI and a non-STEMI? Does anyone, because you had mentioned to me that you wanted me to discuss that. And this part is important. It turns out that almost 50% of the population has some form of dyslipidemia. We know we've already talked about the prevalence of CAD is huge. And now if we look at the patients that come in, they'll all come in and say to me, I'm following my diet, I'm doing these things, why isn't it working for me? Why can't I get my cholesterol down to where I need it just by diet control alone? And the problem is that we have inherited a bunch of genetic disorders that don't allow the metabolism of the bad cholesterol, the LDL, and that there's nothing that these people can do naturally or homeopathically to get their LDLs down to a level where we feel that we've sort of stopped the machinery and that we've decreased the degree of inflammation and the continuing progress of more of this plaque, more of this cholesterol getting deposited in the cell wall. So they're sort of stuck. And so our solutions thus far have been medicines that kind of put a cog, if you're manufacturing something, it puts a wrench right there and stops it. The one we've been using is these statin drugs for all these years, because it ends at the final common pathway of this LDL production, and it just stops it right there. Now we have a new set of drugs, I don't know if you guys heard about, that are injectable, that have an antibody that keeps this receptor, a receptor available to take LDL out of the liver from the bloodstream. And these things are remarkable. We haven't had anything like this for 20 years, but they're expensive as hell. So coming back to the same idea about the atherosclerotic plaque, here's a vessel wall. What's scary is you see in the lower picture, you see that I'm showing a plaque here. A plaque doesn't have much consequence until it decreases the luminal space by 70%. So even here, this is close to 70%, but if you came back a little bit, it would be meaningless in terms of causing a hemodynamic consequence to the patient where he's having angina, where he's having, you know, chest pain or more shortness of breath when he's walking. That wouldn't happen until you decrease this thing to about that. That's when it begins to become an issue. Why is that? Because we have this amazing microcirculation that in those areas where there are vessels that are mildly obstructed or even moderately obstructed, the microcirculation opens up specifically to that area and kind of forces blood in like a vacuum so that you get a steel effect. You get more blood into that area than you would at the other areas, and the microcirculation doesn't dilate in the areas that don't have blocked vessels. So we were talking about what is a STEMI and what is a non-STEMI. What's your understanding of that?
You know, STL, you're going to have significant ST elevation.
Good.
And ischemia.
Good. I'm going to correct you like I got corrected in my first year of post. And it's only thing. So what's the difference when we're infarcting? What's the difference between ischemia and infarction?
Well, infarction's damage.
Right. So that's the key. That's right. So infarction means that we're going from a point where, let's say, it's 99% block, and there is some blood supply getting in there, but the cell's not happy. It's not getting the ATP it needs. It's not getting the energy. It's not dying. Close the vessel completely off, no blood supply, death. So ST elevation is a specific type of heart attack where the vessel, in general, you can think of it like this. Most of the non-STEMIs, what happens is the vessel, you get a plaque rupture, you get a clot forming here, and the clot lyses a little bit, and some of it goes downstream into the microcirculation, and you see some cell death. But it's not a huge wave of cell death where the whole muscle's dying. A STEMI, on the other hand, you're completely blocked, 100% blocked. You get this huge wave of muscle death happening, and it's an emergency. And how does the wave of muscle death start? It starts from the inside, where the blood's actually pumping, here, to the outside. When it gets all the way through from the endocardium to the epicardium, it's called a transmural infarction. All the muscle's dead here. And when that happens, you get a Q wave. And that means that that whole zone of muscle, when the EKG looks at it, it gets no signal from it. Nothing's coming from it. It's like a dead zone, like a black hole. So we used to, before the time of thrombolytic therapy where you pop a clot bust, or before we started putting in stents and everything, we didn't even use to identify the word STEMI. It was called a Q wave infarction or a non-Q wave. And the problem with that thinking is that if you're already at a Q wave, man, you missed the boat. If you want to save something, you want to do it before it's all the way through and through the heart attack. And that's where you guys come in. And we're going to talk about that now. So here's again an increased plaque accumulation, narrowing the artery. This is sort of the paradigm that you guys had told me that you believed in, and I believed in until somebody told me differently, that the research doesn't identify it, that it goes like this from this. More of the time it's here and a complete blockage. These are the more stable ones without the clot. There's more calcium here. There's less inflammatory mediators there. Usually you also need, just in case you ever get tested, there's a core of this plaque that can die. It's called a necrotic core, and that necrotic core releases substances that are more prone to causing that plaque rupture. We talked about this, if you look up on this site, we talked about the risk factors. Why are these risk factors important? Because these risk factors cause vessel wall injury. They also allow the accumulation of the plaque into the vessel wall. And those are the risk factors that we just talked about. Smoking, a genetic predisposition to it, elevated cholesterol, obesity, inactivity. Inactivity, actually, the vessel wall thrives when it gets boluses of blood when we're exercising. It releases vasodilators and keeps the cell wall healthy. So it's not just a theoretical thought that exercise is protective. It really is protective. So these are the risk factors. We get the vascular injury. What causes the vascular injury? We talked about inflammatory mediators. In fact, you'll see a huge number of the patients that you're going to bring in will tell you that they've had some flu-like illness recently prior to the MI. And we think that peaks up the inflammatory mediators when that's going on. Plaque rupture, which was the thing we talked about. And then these local ischemia, which fits in with what you said initially. Then you start to get these metabolic abnormalities. What did I tell you when the metabolic abnormalities happen? Arrhythmias, right? So when you start getting these huge fluxes of potassium coming out, you can get these arrhythmias. But this is also, I want you to understand, this is one of the most important things that I try to tell the ER docs also. This is called the cascade of ischemia, which is interesting to note. If you were to look, let's take a specimen, and we're going to close off one of his arteries, and we're going to follow this cascade of what happens to that muscle as we go along, in order, in terms of what happens first and what happens last. So the first thing that happens is you get local ischemia, you get these electrolyte abnormalities, the muscle gets stiff. After the muscle gets stiff, then it stops moving well. After it stops moving well, only at that point do we start to see the EKG showing signs of ischemia or infarction. And the last thing in the cascade, chest pain. So let's take a scenario where somebody has chest pain, I go look at it, and the EKG looks normal. Well, that doesn't fit. The EKG should go bad before he even perceives the pain. Let's do another one, chest pain, and I go and I do an echocardiogram, and I see that the wall's banging. And he's telling me he's having a heart attack in the front wall of the heart. It doesn't fit. The cascade would say that the muscle has to be down. If the chest pain is caused from a heart attack, the muscle has to be down. It has to not be moving locally in that area where the muscle is. And if you don't see that, that's not a STEMI. And so we do that every day with these guys. We'll say, go get a stat echo if it's ambiguous. They see the walls banging, we're done. It's not possible based on this cascade of how things go. So we talked about this. There's an increased demand for oxygen or a decreased oxygen supply. It can develop within 10 seconds or last longer than 20 minutes. Irreversible cell death occurs. And then we talked about it starts at the endocardium and goes out to the epicardium. Let me ask you a question. If somebody comes into you and says, how long does a heart attack take? Let's say from, we talked about this thing, to be completed if it's a STEMI. How long do you think it takes hour-wise?
Like 1 hour.
1 hour. Okay, any other takers?
I'd say a few hours.
Okay, so I think the answer is partially exactly what you're saying, it is variable. 1 hour, usually no, and that's what we're gonna talk about, this thing called the golden hour, which is where you guys come in. But 6 to 7 hours, so when somebody comes in and says they're having chest pain for 3 days, we've either missed the boat or it wasn't a heart attack. It shouldn't linger like that, especially for a STEMI. You've completed, it's called a completed infarct when you've done it. This is important for you guys to realize because you're gonna run into patients that are gonna be having a STEMI and they're not going to manifest the usual signs that we talk about, chest pain, diaphoresis. And in fact, when you look at all the research of what STEMI, how the classic signs and symptoms were developed, what patient population do you think they were looking at?
Elderly
and mostly male. Perfect, that's right. And so there's all these things called anginal equivalents that women have completely different presentations. Usually theirs is more shortness of breath, fatigue, these kind of things. So you can be fooled. And each individual patient can have different signs. The first sign, which we just talked about, 30% of the patients dying, your first clue when you get to the scene could be this. In fact, you probably, how many of you have come to the scene and seen cardiac arrest where you shock somebody and that was the first, and you shock them back and then you see ST elevation? Have you guys, have any of you had that yet? Right, that's pretty classic, right? That's like, that's the scary one where you're all I imagine you're very nervous to get the patients somewhere off your hands as fast as possible. This is just, again, this algorithm that we talked about, the exposure of these collagen fibers, the microthrombi. The thrombi causes vasospasm, and then you get that full-blown thrombus or clot in the middle of the artery. Stealth S spreads, we talked about that. Length of time of the occlusion depends on how much muscle is going to die, and the presence or absence of collateral circulation. What is collateral circulation? What does that mean?
You develop circulation around the occlusion.
Other vessels take up the slack in the occluded vessel.
Okay, so you're both perfectly right. And the collaterals can come in all sorts of ways. One is what you just said, which is called bridging collaterals, where you can see a complete blockage between two areas and then little links going back them, and they fill the thing. How do you know that that's what it is? Because you'll see all this little network of spider webs, and you'll see the filling's not one-to-one. A little pause there. The other is exactly what you said. We have this huge microcirculation, which we had talked about before. That's what compensates when you have a narrowing. They can vasodilate and grow, and it can come from most commonly, like we'll see, if the right coronary artery is blocked, and we take pictures of the left, you'll see all these collaterals coming in, and we'll see the bottom of the right coronary artery coming in. That's usually a sign that somebody has had a very tight blockage, not 100% for some time, and they've had a chance to develop these collaterals. In an acute STEMI, in general, we don't see that because these people have gone from having, most of the time we said, adequate circulation to suddenly nothing. So they don't have time to develop this adequate circulation. It would be the same thing if I told you, okay, I'm gonna give you guys 2 hours, there's gonna be a blackout and downy. You guys start preparing yourselves for whatever's gonna happen. 2 hour warning, you guys have generators, things in place, now we have the blackout. You're gonna, to some extent, be able to hold up the fort. Now if I just tell you, screw you, blackout now, nothing, right? It's chaos. So that's the same thing as not having a forewarning. The more conditioning the muscle has in terms of being deprived of great oxygen supply, the better it'll tolerate it when the blood supply completely goes. So how do we diagnose a heart attack? I don't know how much you guys know about this, but I'll just tell you the most common marker that we use is troponin. I don't know if you guys have heard of that. Okay, so troponin is just troponin, there's several pieces to the tropomyosin mechanism. This is the mechanism that actually causes the muscle to tighten and then release. These are pieces of that. And we've created these antibodies that we can do an assay and see the quantity of it. And the basic thought is, the more of this you're seeing means more muscle cells died. They lysed all those enzymes and those pieces of muscle apparatus went into the bloodstream. And we can quantitate that. The area under the curve is how much muscle was lost. This is called the zone of infarction. We were talking about it goes from the inside to the out, and then it spreads out from that point. So this is, and forgive me if this isn't completely suited to you guys. It's difficult for me to the gate, you know, I haven't given a talk to non-medical people, although you guys are kind of medical people, so forgive me if it's a little bit, if there's too much or there's something you don't understand, please just tell me, because I go ahead.
So I have a question on the troponin level. So we'll go a lot of times to the ER, they'll call us, and the only complaint, no chest pain, the patient has high troponin.
Right.
How much of an emergency is that when they say, hey, we have high troponin, they need to go to a STEMI, and we've set up a destination to your closest STEMI? How much of an emergency is that, or is it, something, because we've been on calls, high troponin levels, they have an appointment at the cath lab tomorrow morning at 10 a.m., so.
And what is that number?
What is the, troponin mean?
What's high?
What's high?
What's high?
So, okay, so there's two types of assays out there. There's a troponin T and a troponin I. Most, I think, are using troponin T. And why did the troponins come about? Because they're 20 times more sensitive than the old markers. I don't know if there's any old timers here. We used to use CK, or creatine kinase used to be the thing that we would use. But this is 20 times. So there was thousands of heart attacks that we weren't getting that were so small that we didn't pick them up. Well, you could say, well, if they were small, did they really matter? And the truth is, they've done the research. That's a harbinger of something horrible that's about to happen. If you can catch it earlier, the better the outcome for those patients. So what does that mean when I say it's so small? Let's take a football field. Let's say I grab a thatch of grass from the football field, and then I tell you to go look up on the blimp, look down there and tell me, where was that heart attack? You know, where did I take that thatch of grass? You can't see it, right? The field looks completely intact to you. But it's a warning that something's happened. Somebody's invaded. Somebody's entered that space that, or there's something going to happen. So that marker allows us to know things. How high can it get? There's a lot of variables that that tell us how high. If the vessel reopens, let's say like the case of a non-STMI where the vessel 99% blocked, but there is blood supply, the troponin may be 3, right? Maybe 3 instead of 33, but there's something bad going on there and then we still need to take care of it. What's the urgent level of a non-STEMI? Depends if they're having symptoms. If there's ongoing ischemia, it's still emergent. Until you can get the chest pain gone and the EKG changes gone, going back to that cascade, you sort of stop this ischemic event. If you can't quiet them down, they gotta go. You gotta do something. STEMI, on the other hand, if it's a STEMI, if the EKG, which we're gonna show you, is a STEMI, it's an emergency no matter what.
Right, right. Can a troponin level be high and not be...
Be related to an artery being clogged?
Correct.
Absolutely, so that's a great thing. So they've divided these STEMI, or they've decided to describe non-ST elevation MIs. There's several different types of them. The only two that I think you guys would probably be interested in is knowing is the most common thing we see when it's not related to a plaque rupture is called a type 2 STEMI or demand ischemia. This happens, let's say you do have some narrowings, but they're not tight. We talked about that. Or they're moderately tight. And now I make you hypotensive. Okay, now you're hypotensive. Now you need that push, right? So if I tell you you've got to breathe, you're breathing through a big straw, a McDonald's straw, right? Now I'm going to tell you as you're moving down the artery, now I'm going to ask you to blow through a coffee straw for a second, right? Get through that area. You're going to push harder and then you're going to come back into the big straw. So you need a pressure head. When you get to that area, now let's drop your pressure. You can't provide it. So suddenly you're getting this whole zone that's just like, it's waiting for its food and it's like, not coming. Or if you're an army in battle, ammunition please, not coming. You're in deep trouble. So that's... What was the question?
So
that's called a type 2 demand ischemia.
Level be high,
right, so then let's take another option. So hypotension, sepsis with hypotension. In sepsis, we have two things, right? Not only is the patient hypotensive, he's metabolically spiked up, right? 100% spiked up. Everything's working to fight this thing, and now you're not getting fuel. Another is hypoxia. If you don't have a good oxygen level, we know that we're aerobic human beings. We need oxygen. To use it for aerobic metabolism, you don't supply the oxygen, that area down there is going to be the first to get hit. Those are the guys that are on the battlefield at the, you know, that's the front line. They're going to get hit first. Those things, and how do we know they got hit? By this very teeny marker, the troponin goes up, and that gives us an indication something happens. But, so then we go to the cath lab, and more than 30 or 40% of the time we cath them, there's no major blockages. And so then we say, okay, this was demand ischemia, okay? Type 2 MI. Here's just, I'll just give you a one sentence on this. It depends on the location of the heart attack, how the patient's going to present to you. If it's an anterior wall MI, front wall, That artery doesn't just supply the front wall, it provides some branches that feed the sidewall, it also provides the septum in between the left and the right ventricle. That's more than 35% of the myocardium. Those are the patients that are gonna look really, they'll be sweaty, hypotensive, usually tachycardic, because they're trying to compensate for their loss of cardiac output. Anterior wall MI, more of a look of shock. Other types of MIs, let's say it's an inferior wall MI, that affects the vagus nerve and you can get bradycardia. You can also have hypotension, but not necessarily hypotension. But remember the anterior wall MI, which is probably the most devastating if you hit the LAD. If the LAD goes out, especially proximally, does anyone know what that's called? If it's right as the vessel starts off from the big trunk, what's that called? That blocks off 100%. We've all heard this term. Because now you've gone immediately into cardiogenic shock. You have this huge wave of muscle that's metabolically unhappy, and everything's up for grabs. You can have an arrhythmia. You can go into acute cardiogenic shock. So this thing is just basically saying also signs of heart failure would also be in an anterior wall MI more likely than anything else because water starts to back up into the lungs. Because what did we say in the cascade of ischemia? What happens before the muscle stops moving well? It gets stiff. Why is that? Because it's interesting to note that the muscle relaxing requires energy. That's like a trick question. People would say, oh, it shouldn't require energy for a muscle to relax, but it does because that apparatus we talked about with the troponins and everything, in order for it to release and let go, you have to use ATP. It has to have ATP. So that's the first thing that goes down. No ATP, it's like rigor mortis. Okay, so we said that there's STEMI, and we just told you about complete obstruction, and then we talked about the non-STEMI, and then we talked about, for a moment, what's the urgency. We said STEMI in general, is it urgent or non-urgent? Why did I say it's urgent? Why?
Ischemia.
Not ischemia. Injury, building's blocked. You got nothing coming in. Non-STEMI? Probably threw a little clot down to the microcirculation. Some cells died. There's something bad there waiting, but the muscle isn't all dying right now at that time. So STEMI, complete blockage. Non-STEMI, not usually a complete blockage, but there's something bad waiting that needs to be fixed. Quick trick question. Which has a worse prognosis? A patient who presents with a STEMI or a non-STEMI? Which would you think is worse?
Non, because they get picked up. Not because it doesn't get picked up, doesn't get seen?
I think that's true. I think it gets to what it's about, in that the patients who have a non-STEMI usually have developed collateral circulation. They've had occult coronary disease for a long time. The prognosis is about equal. It's just when do you want to pay the price? If it's a STEMI, you're going to pay the price up front because you're going to have this huge wave of infarction. If you survive it, great. If you don't, you die. The non-STEMI, if you look at the events accumulating, maybe at that point you'll do well. If you look at their overall prognosis, they all end up in the shitter. Excuse me. Okay. So this is a good one. Okay, so this is an angiogram. This is what we do the minute you guys send us the patient. We try and get them upstairs. And most of the time we go through the groin, although that's going to stop soon. We're going through the arm. This is a catheter going into the main free trunk of the left heart system. This is the left main. It provides two branches. This is called the circumflex. This provides the lateral wall of the left ventricle and the LAD. This is how it should look. The LAD should come down like this and go all the way down to the apex. It's giving these branches that feed the septum. And although this one doesn't have it, it usually gives branches that feed the sidewall. But when we come to a STEMI, an anterior wall STEMI, the first thing we see is this. Literally, just stopped. Now, does this stop mean that there's no vessel there? Good, right. And so why do we see it this way?
There's no flow. No blood.
Good. I'm not trying to be patronizing, but it's important that you understand this is a luminogram. In other words, the vessel is here, but this is just contrast going through the inner lumen, and it stops suddenly because of exactly what you just said. There's a clot here. If I can clear that clot and open it, suddenly I'm going to see the vessel right here. Not that the vessel isn't there, it's just that in my luminogram, right, where I'm pouring contrast through this. And how am I seeing this? I'm completely eliminating the blood flow for that few seconds and replacing the blood with contrast material for that few seconds. And it's very often that patients will get ischemic even when we do this because they're getting nothing other than contrast for this moment in time. We replace the whole cascade, the whole vessel with that. So, an anterior wall or an ST elevation myocardial infarction, this is, where's your understanding? I'll just tell you. And how much time do I have to finish this thing so that I don't overdo you?
We're looking for about noon, but if you need to go a little over, that's fine.
I don't think it'll last to noon, so that's okay. I think you'd be dead by noon. poor dead. Okay, so what is the ST segment? This is the ST segment. How are we comparing it? Let me start off with something a little more basic. Does anyone know what this is?
P wave.
What does it mean?
PR.
Polarization.
Repolarization.
Depolarization.
Depolarization.
Okay, good. Does the atrium contract right here once the electricity shows the depolarization? No, there's a delay. That's the electric signal. The mechanical contraction happens during the QRS. And the QRS, which we say is the ventricular contraction, it doesn't really contract, the muscle doesn't contract until you get to the T wave, which is what we call repolarization of the ventricle. So everything is delayed. The electric signal is a little bit before the actual contraction, right? But we go through specialized muscle cells that allow a normal EKG to have this narrow look to it. And we'll talk about when we don't have that specialized electric system in place, like in a left bundle branch block, these morphologies change and it's not useful. You can't look at a STEMI in a left bundle branch block because it's not going through the special electric system. The ST segment is the segment comparing here. This is the PR segment. This would be a normal ST segment. We see that they're on the same line, correct?
Mm-hmm.
Or close to the same line. What happens in an acute myocardial infarction is that this area right here, and we're gonna look two boxes outside of this point, two little boxes, okay, you're gonna see that it's gonna come up. And so we're comparing this to this, okay? So normal and elevated. Do we only need one lead, one EKG lead to show that to call it a STEMI?
Two.
And those two leads in general, is there anything that they need to have in common?
Together.
What does that mean?
Contiguous.
Contiguous. What does that mean?
Something like
12 degrees. Good. So you're getting the right. Right. They should be leads that are representing the same area of muscle. So that's what you're telling me, right?
Yeah.
You're right. The first thing that you'll see if you're lucky enough, and I've seen it a few times, is this thing called the hyperacute T wave, where the T waves just go whoosh, before the ST even goes up. That's the very first sign of a STEMI. The other thing is this thing, reciprocal changes. Does anyone know what that means? Have you heard that term before? I love to use that in the ER. The ER doctors think if I can tell you that I have to take the patient to the cath lab because it must be real. So the larger, more profound the heart attack, you will see mirror changes on the opposite side of the heart. And those opposite, so what would be opposite to ST elevation? ST depression. So ST depression in leads that are opposite, facing away from it, give you more credence this is probably real. It validates it. Because we get a lot of false positives. I don't know if you guys know that, but 40% of the STEMIs that we get called in on are not real. Not real, not because of you guys. And I would say it's like appendixes. You've heard physicians should be, if you're not finding false positive appendixes, you're not taking out enough appendixes. Have you ever heard that expression about surgeons? Why is that? Because the result of missing one is catastrophic. So if you're giving us false positives, it's okay. The goal of today is to try and make it a little less or to make you a little more discerning. But I think if you think it's real, bring them, because it's the result of not bringing them is catastrophic. And part of that is the timing, which we're going to talk about, this golden hour and everything. The faster you get them to me, the better the results for the patient. There's no question. Trial data, and we're going to go over it, proves that. No question, the faster he gets to me, and the faster I open the artery, the better he'll do. Okay, so leads facing the, we talked about that, T waves become tall and widened. Here's an example. What do you think this kind of heart attack is? So here we got this blockage. Is it completely blocked?
No.
Good. What do you think that is? What kind of heart attack would that, oh shit, it says.
Not semi.
Good. Patient had a heart attack. Patient has a huge amount of muscle at risk down here, right? But he is getting some blood supply. If he's having active chest pain and he's actively infarcting, I got to do something. How do I know if it's active and not quiet? Pain and ST depression. ST depression is usually synonymous with non-STEMI and ischemia, which one of you had said ischemia and infarct. So ST depression is ischemia. If he has that ongoing and he's having chest pain, I got to do something. If I can shut him up and he's quiet, not by giving him morphine, I have a little bit of time. But the research has shown, because people ask, well, how long can you wait it out? The sooner you get to these guys, the better they do. It's not as urgent, but 24 to 48 hours, they should be in the cath lab. You should not be waiting days and days. They don't do as well. What is this?
It's like backup.
What is it?
It looks like it's backed up.
Good, okay, you're right. For the moment, at that one moment, it is backed up. So this is this LED, somebody put a wire down here. That wire, like a tram train, it has two lumens, and one lumen the wire goes through, and we bring that all the way to this area, and then we blow up the balloon. The balloon has contrast in it. So for that moment, you're seeing we are complete, exactly what you just said. All the blood from here, not getting, nothing getting down for that 10 seconds while that balloon's up. We let go of the balloon, blood flow returned. Well, where did all that that crap go? Well, the crap either, part of it goes downstream, which is bad because it'll block out microcirculation, we'll lose some more muscle, and part of it is just smashed up against the walls. But we've restored blood flow, right? No longer are we in this situation where he's ischemic, he has ample blood supply. That's an angioplasty, that's what we started with. Go ahead.
Real quick, because I don't know how long you have, but you, looks like no one heard your laptop. Your battery signal and upper right.
Oh, okay. I brought a. That's my guy.
There's a plug right at the foot in there.
Yes.
IT.
Boy, James.
Making a presentation. Okay. Thank you. Appreciate that. So we talked about ST depression. We said is synonymous with infarct or ischemia. Good. ST elevation. Good. What's a Q wave? Is a Q wave a good thing? Why? What did I tell you it means? Can you miss the boat?
Yeah. Old damage.
It's all damage. It's dead. Transmural, all the way through that muscle. Here's some different pictures of different types of, this is a non-STEMI. This person was having a non-STEMI, and this is a representation of how they came. This is very subtle. It's just a T-wave inversion. Here we see, what do we see here? Here's the PR interval. Here's the ST segment. Is it depressed or elevated? Depressed, good. And I forgive, again, when I'm doing this, I'm trying to be, I'm not, I don't think any of you are stupid. I'm just trying to get it out of you so that you'll remember what I'm saying. So please, I do the same exact thing to the everybody. Okay, here, depressed or elevated?
Elevated.
Okay, here's subtly elevated, right? Minimally. How much do we need it to be? So there's criteria that are different, but at least 1 to 2 millimeters. I don't even remember all the things. If it's anterior, it only has to be 1. There's a bunch of other stuff, but I think 1 to 2, it should be, and you should see it exactly what you told me in contiguous leads. So here's some different presentations of the evolution of an acute heart attack. Where you're again seeing you're going from a little ST depression suddenly to ST elevation. Can this happen? Can you have a patient who has a non-STEMI suddenly become a STEMI? Sure as hell isn't going to take a lot, right? You got 99% blockage, a little bit of irritation, and the thing clots off completely. Now we've gone from non-STEMI, STEMI. So yes, it can happen. Okay, let me go to the next. Sure. Okay, so you guys know this nonsense? That the two major coronaries that feed the heart, the left and the right. In most cases, what does the right feed? 70 to 80% of the time. This will be easy for you to remember. It feeds the bottom. So most inferior wall myocardial infarctions generally involve the right coronary artery. Okay? And then the right coronary artery has branches, but it's its only vessel. In the left system, it starts off as a big tree trunk, and then divides into one that goes down the front wall and one that goes to the side. The big tree trunk is called the left main. If that closes off, you will die. You will die. And you probably all run into somebody who is in cardiac. You're not going to, if you can get them and it opened a little bit, you may save their life. Otherwise, they're going to die. Why? You're talking like 60% of their myocardium down immediately. Cardiogenic shock, whatever it is. And the two, we talked about the LAD. The LAD is the most important artery because we talked about that it feeds more than just one wall. It feeds the anterior wall, some of the side wall, and that septum, which is a wall, right? This is, if everything's coming in here, and one of these walls is the septum, it's equally as important as the other walls. Okay. So this is, the right coronary artery supplies the right atrium, the right ventricle, and the inferior posterior wall. I want to make one point about this. We're going to look at some right coronary artery occlusions. It depends, a big important part of that we understand is where is it blocked in the artery? The closer to its beginning that it's blocked off, the more muscle that's jeopardized, right? So let's say we're going to bring you guys, we got a big fire, you're going to do a forest fire. We're going to bring you guys there. And the bus, and on the bus route, the bus goes down right when we get to the first thing, and no one's coming. If we can get halfway there, or if we get halfway there, and then someone fixes it, we only have half the passengers. The further down, the less muscle damage. The further down the vessel wall, the artery you are, the less muscle at risk. The closer you come back, the larger the zone of infarction. Does that make sense to you? And in the right coronary artery, if it goes out right at its beginning, you can also lose the right ventricle. And those patients do very poorly. 50% of them die. So we're going to talk about this now. Let's go over. So what is this?
Is that the bone?
That's your brain on drugs.
Ciao.
I assume this is an LED.
What's it?
A balloon?
No, that's not a balloon. You think this guy's doing well?
No, clot.
You guys think this guy's doing well? Why do you think he's not doing well?
His heart
is not in his body.
Cancer, he's dead. Why is he dead? They're trying to show you. So this is a big thrombus sitting in, I don't know whether this is the LED or not, but this is what it would look like. You got blood and suddenly this big clot and nothing getting down you. And you see some area here that's probably already starting to necrose or die. I don't know what this picture was trying to show you. I think this is another occlusion, but I'm going to move on. We said that the posterior inferior wall is the right coronary artery. We talked about that. If it involves the right ventricle, you're not going to see it in the same weeds, but I think that's too much for you guys. What artery do you think this is? Which of the three coronary arteries did we say starts off on its own and ends on its own? Left circumflex LED or right coronary artery?
Right.
Good. Very good. So that's right. So here's our little catheter. Dye, nothing. Little branch, nothing. The artery should have come down all the way out to here and fed the bottom part of the heart. We're not seeing it. So this guy's going to be very sick because it's at the beginning of the artery, right? That whole muscle zone, everything's going down. As opposed to if the artery was blocked halfway down where there was more branches that are still open, this guy's going to be sicker. This is an illustration of these coronary arteries. Where do the coronary arteries come off? It's interesting. The coronary arteries come off right where the aortic valve is, right where the valve cusps are. That's where the opening, the ostiums to these arteries are. So here's our right coronary artery. And what is it feeding? It's feeding the inferior part of the myocardium, right, of the left ventricle. And again, everything we talked about is left ventricle. Left main out here, this is the LAD. It's feeding the front wall, the septum, and it should be getting off some branches to the side wall. What branch is this if this is the lateral wall? Remember, lateral, LL, left circumflex. Lateral wall, left circ. Okay, and we're going to talk about which leads those are. Just another illustration of the same thing. Okay. This is kind of a cool picture that gives you what leads are picking it up. So think of the EKG as an eyeball that's looking from its perspective at the whole depolarization of the left ventricle from its vantage point. Each of the leads has a different vantage point of where it's looking at it. For example, if we're looking at V6, my eyeball is over here. I'm looking at how does the normal depolarization go? Well, the normal depolarization of the whole left ventricle goes a little bit to the right, and then all of it moves to the left. And so that whole current should move that way. If the whole current should move that way, if my eyeball's here, I'm going to see everything coming at me, which is a positive deflection. Okay? If it's living tissue out here, I'm going to see a positive deflection. If it's going away from me, I'll see a negative deflection. If the whole vector of electricity is moving away from me. So each of these leads provides a different vantage point of where the electricity, in terms of viewing that whole depolarization, billions of muscles going to becoming activated at the same time. So again, here's another one. So let's start beginning to understand what leads. And you guys have some cheat sheet there, right? She gave you some little thing. It's not a little card.
Oh,
you guys have that?
Yeah, she only had a few of them.
Okay. Maybe, so hopefully you'll get more of this. But looks like she's already telling you this, but so inferior leads, and look, they're already cheating and telling us most of the time that the right coronary artery feeds that, 2-3 and AVF, okay? Septum, what is septum? Septum means when the LAD is occluded, usually beyond the first perforator here, V1 and V2. We're gonna go over, we're gonna do some examples, and we'll try and look at it. V3, V4 is when the LAD is occluded more beyond its beginnings over here, and the lateral V5, V6, and then these leads, however, most of these leads are precordial leads. These are, what are these called? Limb leads. They're vectors. They're leads that rely on two leads watching something cross a boundary. Okay, so here's a, this is kind of confusing also. If I could, is there a way to get you guys a copy of these to look over? My slide, he probably knows how to get, we can copy this and give it to them.
You could, if you want to email it to Christina or myself, and then I could.
I'm going to have him do it, because I don't know how to do it.
Okay.
James.
So let's start quizzing. I don't have any other way other than like when you have to learn spelling words other than rote learning, but we're going to go over some. So anterior septal infarct, what leads are involved? Just everybody say after me, V1, V2, V3, V4. Okay, anterior lateral, V4, V5, V6, AVL, and 1. We'll see if you remember this. Inferior leads, 2, 3, AVF. And I don't want to get into this posterior wall thing, I think it's too confusing for now. Okay, what's going on in this EKG? Is the patient having a STEMI?
Oh, this looks like non-STEMI.
How about it doesn't look like anything? It's a normal EKG.
Oh, wait, are we saying non-STEMI?
But good, you got the idea. So what went through your head during this process, as you said? I don't see any ST elevation, maybe some ambiguous ST elevation in one lead. Two, I don't see it in several leads. There's no reciprocal changes. We said ST depression in the opposite, looking from the opposite end. So you're right, this is a normal EKG. If they come to you, are you gonna call a STEMI here? You better not. Okay. Let's look at this one. What do we got?
Inferior.
Mm. 2-3 AVF.
Good. Now, if you're a big shot and you're in the ER, what might you mention to me on the phone? Good. Someone come here and show me the reciprocal changes. Go up there and show me where those are. That's right.
My man.
Right here.
Good. What are you seeing? So you're seeing ST depression in the leads that are opposite the inferior wall, right? That's the anterior wall? Good. Okay, so good. This is a STEMI. And this is an inferior wall STEMI.
And it looks pretty
profound, doesn't it? We have several millimeters of ST elevation going on, and we have reciprocal changes, so it's believable. What artery is this? Seems like there's only one artery coming here.
The right.
Good. That's the right. Good. If we lose this branch, they even get sicker, because then the RV can go down. If we close off here, he's losing more muscle, the right and the left. So this is a little further down. This is in the middle of the artery, right? Remember, the first one we had seen was way up here. That guy's sicker. Right? Because he loses everything. Nothing's getting down. Here, at least he's got this branch feeding some muscle, but everything from here on is out.
So is this a bad guy that's going to be super affected by necro?
Well, let's talk about that. So why, what, this is a question that's often asked. So why do we say in an inferior wall MI we shouldn't give nitro?
Because of preload issues?
That's a perfect answer. That's correct. Because you're reliant on your preload. So if you drop the preload,
is this what you would see?
Not necessarily. This one would probably be sicker. Because it would involve the right ventricle as well.
So
the right ventricle is completely preloaded. Right. Higher up just means that the clot happened more close to its origin, and every area of muscle beyond that is not getting blood. So here, is this right ventricle getting some blood supply? It is. That's not clot off. It's below that where the clot happened. It's everything below it that's in trouble now. So again, keep the idea in mind, the further down the line it is that the clot happens, the less affected generally the patient should be. So preload dependent is because the right ventricle, it actually almost acts as a transit for blood to come through. It doesn't have much, it's a much thinner wall than the left ventricle, much thinner. We'll probably have a picture of that. And so it relies on that preload. The same thing that we just talked about, the straw blowing, on the right side, to get that stuff through the system, you have to have some pressure front. If I drop it by giving nitroglycerin, or I give morphine, or any of these drugs that vasodilate more of the periphery, and suddenly I drop my pressure from 5 atmospheres to 2 atmospheres, it's not going to get across. What's the effect of not getting blood through the right ventricle? What happens to the left ventricle?
It's starving.
It's starving. It's getting less blood. What happens to our systemic blood pressure?
Drop.
Okay.
Good. Worse, better than the last one?
That looks bad.
Why? It's more proximal, right? It's occurring more towards the origin of the vessel, of the beginning of the vessel. And I showed you that picture once before. So, I don't want to go through this posterior wall of mine. Okay, here's another one. Is it STEMI or not STEMI?
No.
Are you sure? Who says STEMI? You do. Where is the STEMI? I see you have a cheat sheet up there. Look at your cheat sheet. Good. So where is this artery kind of going?
Septal.
Interior? Septal. Interoceptal.
Good. Excellent. Is the ER going to have bragging rights to tell me I have to take the patient?
Do you what?
Someone come up here and show me something on that EKG, not the guy who showed me the last time. Come here and show me. Is there anything here that's more convincing that makes you even more convinced? We talked about that last time. This guy. You go up there. Show me
when.
Me? Yeah, you.
Oh shit. It's 3:18. So I was. The things I was looking at was how high the isometric line is here, or it's really peaked above, and then we have a lot of depression
good.
There and there.
What are those called?
There. That's what says depression.
No, you're right about depression. But where's the what's the main event in town? Where's the big show?
Ischemia. So, and then got
something right here.
What is that?
Those are all peak T waves.
Their ST elevation, right? That's the big show. The big show is the infarct going on in the interior. Well, what's those things that you showed me?
This is showing what you're having.
That's the reciprocal change. This is looking from below, saying, "Holy shit! Look at the sky falling." This is the reciprocal changes. These are the ST depressions. This is a mirror of what's going on in the top part of the heart. This is the opposite effect. Just like if you had a reflection, this is the reflection on the bottom part of the heart of that same event that's going on here. But what's the major event? The major event's up here. Good.
Job, John.
I want to ask you, does anyone see anything in lead B2 that I don't like? So when you're reading these EKGs from left to right, the first thing that you see that goes down, the first down going thing is what?
What did you say? B2, the P wave.
Not the P wave. What's it, in the QRS complex, or in looking at the ventricle depolarizing, the first down going thing?
Q?
Q wave.
So do you think that we may have missed some of this?
Yeah.
Uh-oh. That's the uh-oh sign. Already something in the septum. This is more of the septum. We're already getting some aspect of Q-ing. Now, if all the Q's were there, and they were big, deep Q waves, remember, Q is just the first down-going thing when you're reading from left to right in the QRS complex. And we said that's synonymous with transmural infarction, or dead. Okay, here's that. We've seen this picture where... What leads would be involved? Which ones?
V3, V4,
tell me again?
V3 and V4? For the interior?
What does the LAD feed?
ABL.
Good. And what's the so anterior descending would be which leads represent the anterior wall? Okay. Remember that we talked about that septum is these things, these little branches that come off like this. This is a septal perforator. So if we block before the first septal perforator, i.e. the widowmaker, it would not just be V3 and V4, V2 would be affected also, right? Because we've now hit the wall, that septum. So that's a widowmaker. That's the one. Now we opened it, and we have flow resuscitated. The septum's getting blood now. The whole anterior wall's getting blood. Okay, who's going to do this one? the most likely culprit artery?
Inferior.
Right. Good, so what do we say? We said 75% of the time, the right coronary provides the inferior wall. Is this convincing?
Yeah.
Anything more convincing here?
The mirror.
That guy.
Yeah.
What do you see there? Oh, you again.
Oh, shit. So I see more elevation again in leads 2 and 3.
Good, agreed, that's the main show.
Right.
You got any reflection? Any reflection from the opposite wall?
Yes, B1.
Yes, you're right. What is that called?
Depression.
Reciprocal. The good news is you'll never forget this.
Oh, shit, the sky's falling.
I got a question for you, Doc.
Go for it.
Have to ask this. So, I had 100% occlusion of the LAD.
You personally?
Yes.
Okay.
And I had 70% below that. They couldn't get a clean anterior 12 lead. They had to put it posteriorly on me to interpret it as a STEMI.
And this was an LAD occlusion you had? And, okay. That's odd. I don't know. Where in the LAD was it occluded? Do you know if it was down in the middle or somewhere? You don't know.
I'm not sure.
I would say that speaks to the idea that there's a lot of ambiguity that goes into this sometimes. Sometimes you'll see it's a non-STEMI and the vessel's completely blocked and it didn't follow this algorithm that I'm telling you at all, because we're simple humans that are trying to make sense of things, but it doesn't always make sense. So I'm not sure why. It may have been very downstream and your LAD may have wrapped around and provided the inferior posterior wall. We see that a lot where the artery doesn't just go to the apex, it actually can come across. If this is the ventricle, you can see sometimes the LAD will come off and then it'll actually come all the way down to here and break off. So then you would imagine that not only are you affecting the anterior wall, the septum, the apex, but also the inferior portion of this wall, and that can give you ST elevation, I would assume, posteriorly. Did you have any other blockages, or that was it?
There was
in the LED,
there was a 70% below that.
But nothing in the other coronaries? No. Yeah, so that's the only scenario that I can imagine that you had a wrap, what's called a wraparound LED. Okay, where's this one? Did we already do it? No, so this one?
Inferior.
Any other portion of the myocardium involved?
It looks like maybe a little bit of lateral.
Good, excellent. Perfect. So here's our donut. Right, so you are seeing some of these lateral leads picking up. Which lateral leads do you see?
5 and 6. Mm-hmm.
One, that's a lateral lead, right? I don't know if she wrote that, but
my head isn't as good as yours, but about
artery.
Yeah. 5 and 6 look real good, though.
Yeah, I agree. So, what artery is this most likely the culprit of? What's the most likely culprit of this artery? This is the heart, and this is this, here's the anterior, the LAD. Good, excellent. Somebody label these for me? Come up there and label. Is that him? There's no big one. Nope. Let's pick up somebody else.
Recruit, get up there.
This guy. Don't worry. No, you. No. All right, you want to do it? That's fine.
His penmanship's horrible.
Trust me, that's cool. That's our whole idea. It's humiliation. Learning through humiliation. That's our main strategy.
Nope.
That's good. Now he's humiliated. He'll remember.
The right side
is
the left side.
Right, what did we say starts as one artery and not a big free trunk? Starts as one artery and stays as one artery.
On the right, RC.
Now you remember. The right. Where should that be? What part of the ventricle?
Inferior.
Good. Okay, so this is the front. This is the one that's going down the front. This is what you said. Left anterior descending. Anterior means front. Left anterior descending. This is our LAD. So let's re-label that. So what's that other artery that you were calling the LAD?
With a callback and with a voicemail.
Good. And then what's this big tree trunk called? Where everything starts from? Nope, but you're close. This one? this is the left main, it starts with a big tree trunk, sorry. And then the aorta is right here, so here's the aorta arch. And it's coming around like that. And this is our heart. So this the big tree trunk where it starts is the left main. Remember, it's just in the tube. What did I tell you happens if we close here? And then what happens to most people? Good. All right. So where this infarct involves which vessel? The one on the screen.
That would be the right.
You sure you want to stay with that? Although I do see, I can't really argue that there's some ST elevation here. I'm gonna give you credit. I do see some ST. So sometimes it's confusing. So how could that possibly be that we're seeing this? Well, that could be because this right coronary artery gives off branches. It gives off one that feeds the middle and one that can come up and feed this part of the sidewall. So this might be either a right coronary artery that has branches that feed out to the lateral wall, or it may be a circumflex. 25% of the time, the circumflex gives off a branch that does what the right coronary artery does most of the time. I don't know. This is ambiguous. I couldn't tell you which it was going to be. It's probably the dominant circumflex, but I couldn't tell you.
So do you find this with dye then? Is that the only way you see between which way you're going to put like a stent or whatever?
Okay, so let's talk about what's the front. So you guys, somebody detail me when the patient gets to the emergency room. What do you think happens? From our, once you drop them off, what do you think? Because I've invited some of you. Any of you guys come upstairs with us to see? Okay. So tell us, what happens once you drop them off, what happens?
I have no idea what you're
doing. Oh, that's good. Well, that's who's been there. We talked about how important time and muscle is. So what's our job once you get them, drop them off, if it's a real STEMI?
Open it up as quickly as possible.
Yeah.
Good. So how do we do it? So in the coronary angiogram, most of the time, at least for us, we're poking here in the groin. We're putting a little plastic tube here that's hollow that has a sealable thing that every time we take something out, it seals so they're not bleeding out. We take a very slender tube up and we engage it into the opening of this artery. And it's a special catheter that some guy invented that most of the time an idiot can get it to go in. And it's hollow. Right? And then I shoot contrast through here, the column comes up here, and it completely opacifies the vessel, right? Everyone with me? So usually most of us, at least most people will do the non-pulpered artery first and then they'll go in with a catheter that they can already start working with. I don't do that. But. So your question was, how do you know where to start? Wasn't that sort of what you were asking me? So we complete a diagnostic angiogram. We'll take pictures of the left and we'll take pictures of the right. Why do we want to know everything? Why don't you just say, well, if opening that artery immediately is the most important thing, why are you screwing around looking at the other artery? Just get to work.
While you're in there, you might as well fix whatever else you might find.
That poses a great question, but that's not really the reason. Because you want to know what you're up against. Let's say we go in there. I just did a guy. You guys sent me a guy a few weeks ago that I ended up sending over to USC. I get in there. This guy's having an anterior wall MI, or an inferior wall MI. I get in there. I take a picture of his right coronary artery. It's closed off. Okay, I expected that, right? I go over to his left system. His left circumflex completely closed off. And his LAD is completely closed off after the first branch. Now, is this a guy who's gonna fare well with us?
No.
He's fucking in shock already. Now he's down to one diagonal. Yeah. So I'm gonna approach this guy differently. That guy, I put in this new thing. Have you guys heard of this Impella? It's exciting stuff. You're going to hear more about it. We have it. Lakewood has it. You guys do a lot to Lakewood, right?
Mm-hmm.
So it's a device that completely can give you its cardiac output on its own. It's basically a sub pump that you put in the ventricle. It sucks from the ventricle in and then pushes it out into the aorta. So it actually, and it can generate a whole cardiac output on its own. And this was the first one we did. We used to put balloon pumps in, which augment things, but they don't give you a complete cardiac output. So I put that thing in. And then we went to try and open the artery. I wasn't successful opening it because everything had been closed off for a long time, and I sent him to have some guy who's a guru try and open the artery. But what was my point? Oh, why do you want to look at all the arteries? Because you want to know what you're up against. Your question, or whoever said, oh, because you're there, you might want to open up more. There's a whole debate going on about that. The only time, what we're supposed to follow is do the culprit. The vessel that's causing this heart attack. It has been proven that doing the other vessels before they go home is better, but at the sitting of the initial heart attack, you should just do the culprit. There's one exception, cardiogenic shock. If they're in shock, you want to recruit as much muscle as you can. So if there's other vessels and they're still in shock, go ahead and open them at that sitting. But in general, for you guys, let's just remember the idea we're going to get the culprit. But we want to see what's out there before we go fishing, before we get there, because we wanted to anticipate this guy's going to get sick. Does he need to be intubated? Forget about this one. Okay, what is this picture?
Is that an Ella, like an LVAD device?
Exactly.
Like one we would see.
You're not going to see it, and you won't see it in your. What I would suggest is when you go up, if the patient looks really sick, you can ask them, so you think this guy's going to get an impeller, and come up and watch it being put in. It's not something that can be put in the field.
Well, but if that was your question. Like we have like four people in Downey right now that have LVADs, just right now. And so like, is that impeller, you know, one of those.
Is it permanent? It's like, not permanent. Is that, because the LVADs usually.
That's what I'm saying. Yeah, they just wait until they get a new heart or whatever.
Yeah, no, it's not. It is a bridge, but it's not that type of a bridge. Everything's exposed. The infection risk is up. They can be left in place for about a week at most. So it's not. But it serves the same idea. A left. What does LVAD stand for?
Left ventricular assist device.
Good. So this Impella is a left ventricular assist device. It's just not as. It's not. Doesn't have that same permanent ability. But it does. But it's something that can be put in a hell of a lot faster, and it doesn't have to be put in by a cardiothoracic surgeon. We can put it in. So that's the advantage. Okay. So this is. What is this picture representing? Forget about this. I already gave up on this. But this is more or less just letting you know where these leads are placed. All of you know. You guys put the leads yourselves, don't you? Okay, so now you can see that V1 and V2 is the anterior wall. If the heart's coming down here, you see why the eyeball's looking at the anterior wall. Coming out here in the lateral, you see that it makes sense to you now that this is the lateral wall that it's viewing. That's for a right-sided infarct, which I just don't think you're going to. If you want to discuss that after we're done, I'm happy to discuss that.
We're asking why is V4 over on the right side of the chest?
Okay, so if you, we'll talk for a minute about it. If you have an inferior wall MI, the patient's hypotensive and dying in the field, and you don't see frank ST elevation, that may be an RV infarct. Or he has evidence of an inferior infarct and he's sicker than he should look. If you were to place this opposite lead out here to V4R and you see ST elevation, that means the right ventricle is getting hit also. And that will explain to you why this guy's sicker than he should be. Okay, so that's the utility of this particular lead lets you know that this was that the RV is now involved. And how did I say those guys fare? If you lose the RV, 50% mortality. And they do have a device for the RV now also, by the way. The same people who make Impella make an RV Impella. We don't have it. Yeah, but it would be that kind of case where you weren't getting any forward flow to the left ventricle, you could put that device in. So this is just some numbers looking at how many people come in with these things in the United States. 1.57. What's ACS stand for? What's that?
Cardiac syndrome.
Good. Acute coronary syndrome. And that's a catch-all. Acute coronary syndrome involves unstable angina. There's no evidence of an infarct, but the patient's having symptoms of active ischemia. That includes a non-STMI. And really, an ACS can include a STEMI also. So it's a catch-all phrase. When you start to break it down, this is what you see in terms of what we're admitting. 1.24 million non-STEMIs and 0.33 million admissions per year for STEMI. Let's see. 683 patients were discharged from the hospital with acute coronary syndromes last year, which is pretty big. STEMI represents, we said, about 25 to 40% of all those MIs. It's decreased significantly, the death from STEMI. And we see that's, why do you think that that's the case? Why do you think that the death rate from STEMI has gone down over time substantially? Early identification. Does that help you? If you do something about it. And that's where you guys come in. The sooner we do something about it, the better. And that we have two potential ways to open an artery. Where you guys are, we're in the middle of the city, the most reliable and best way and fastest way to do that is opening it with a balloon. However, if you're in the middle of nowhere, there's another way. Anyone know what that is? I don't know if any of you ever work in any other areas that are not in the city. Okay, it's thrombolytics. This is what we had before. You give this drug in the emergency room, and about 60% of the time the vessel would open. The heart attack's over. The vessel still could be 90% blocked, but it's opened a little bit. poked a hole through. So now you've gone from a STEMI to a non-STEMI, quiet the patient down, and then he needs to go to the cath lab before he's discharged. So look at that. We're going to talk about the golden hour. Look at this thing. They seek medical care for they wait 1 to 2 hours after symptom onset. And this is the part that I think that you guys can play more of a role than we can. And this hasn't changed over 10 years. With, you know, we think that we're becoming enlightened, and we're not. People are still stubborn, sitting at home, having a STEMI for 2 hours. And the importance of that is the longer they wait, the more muscle they lose. And that has been shown in studies to mean that their chance of surviving is much less. So they're longer in women, blacks, elderly, and Medicaid recipients, and they're shorter for Medicare recipients. And this is just because these Medicare recipients are probably more educated and understand these things, and the others don't. And that's a bad thing. And it's our obligation to try and teach people, everyone, that these signs are urgent and there's nothing to screw around with, you know? The majority of STEMI deaths occur in the first 2 hours due to cardiac arrest. Less than 50% of STEMI patients call 911 and are transported to the hospital by you guys. Less than 50%. So you guys don't even know, we're missing half of it. Pre-hospital 12 EKG acquisition is critical for determining which chest pain patients need to be transported for PCI facility, because the majority of the chest pain patients do not have STEMI, right? I mean, I don't know how many, 70% of the stuff you see is not STEMI, right? So, and if it's STEMI, we just talked about it, the artery's completely occluded, it's an emergency. Pre-hospital ECGs are required on less than 10% of suspected STEMI patients, even though they can decrease the door-to-needle and door-to-balloon times. Door-to-needle is just what we talked about, thrombolytics, if you're gonna give a clot buster through the needle. So this is a good picture of what we talked about, this golden hour, and how much muscle are you gonna salvage. So here's our donut. Everything's myocardium, everything's muscle. 40 minutes into the infarct, now all this jelly is dead muscle. Guy waits 3 hours, all this is dead. This is the only viable myocardium. And this again shows you the picture that it's the outward most, the epicardium is what goes last. Guy waits greater than 6 hours, he's got a jelly donut, a lot of jelly. Not much to salvage here, right? That's the only salvageable muscle, the rest is not viable. This is like this golden hour. This part actually pertains more to you guys than us. The golden hour, what this is showing, percent of heart muscle saved from onset of heart attack to the emergency room treatment. And what you see is that, look at this slope. The amount, if you can get this vessel open in the first 90 minutes, which is not an hour, but that's called the golden hour, 90 minutes instead of 60 minutes. 90 minutes is the golden hour. Look at the amount of muscle you salvage. Almost all of it. Just lose the sliver. But then you start to come out. Look at, you're losing more and more muscle as you move on. So you're not losing a whole bunch in this first 90 minutes. You salvage almost everything. You come out here, you've lost all that weight. You come out here, you almost have nothing. So this is this time from symptom onset, number of lives saved per 1,000 patients. Remember, everything in medicine, and all the science is very interesting, but the bottom line is if you're a patient, you want to know about your life being saved, or you living a better life after you get out of the hospital. That's what's important to you, not all this science and muscle and all, who gives a crap? That's not something you're thinking about. This is what you're thinking about. Number of lives saved per 1,000 patients from the time of onset to the time that they open the artery. So look at the number of patients we can save per 1,000 if we can get this artery open within the first hour. And look how precipitously the number of lives saved decreases by the time you're out here at 12 to 24 hours. So it's really true that we know that. This is the same exact thing looking at it at the amount of death per time wasted. So the immediate goal for any acute STEMI is to restore normal coronary blood flow to the vessel and salvage muscle. And we talked about that there's a number of ways to do that. These are the indications for STEMI MIs. They should be given within 12 hours of symptom onset. So here's the difference between us and the clot busters. We can open the vessel even after 12 hours if they're still having symptoms. They have no indication after 12 hours. We can open the vessel if they have contraindications to getting thrombolytics. They've had a recent bleed in their head, or they're having active bleeding somewhere else. This will affect us also, but not to the extent of giving thrombolytics where they'll bleed out. Pregnancy, ulcer, these would be, again, indications not to use thrombolytics, but we would be in favor. This is a depiction of what we do. Here's this wire that's already through the vessel. Here's this balloon that has two cores. We said there's an inner core where the wire follows, and then another core where we fill up with contrast. And we go up with contrast. This is called PTA, or plain old balloon angioplasty. We come back with a balloon that has a stent crimped on it. It's tight. And when we blow up the balloon, the stent deploys, and it creates a scaffolding. Balloon goes down. We pull it out. The stent stays. What is our goal in STEMI? Open the artery as fast as possible, restore blood flow. Two ways to achieve it, we talked about that already. So if time is muscle and loss of muscle is proportional to loss of life in STEMI, how do we decide on the best method for revascularization? Here the answer is, what can we get done faster? If we have access to us, go to us. If there's no access, thrombolytics. There, the chance of opening the artery is about 60%. The chance of us opening the artery, greater than 90%. The durability is different. Our durability is very durable because we mechanically open the artery. Their durability, 30 to 40% of them will reocclude within time and they'll have another STEMI if you don't do anything mechanical to that artery. But it's not available everywhere. So, I mean, if it's an option and it's the right option, if it's going to take more than, if you can open the artery their way faster, you should do that. Whatever the fastest way to opening the artery is. Here it's faster for us to do it. I'm not going to go through that. I don't think it matters to you guys. Okay, so here's this thing. So if medical care is not provided, death occurs in almost 1/4 of the cases. Half of the deaths occur within the first 24 hours of the onset of symptoms. About 40% of all affected patients die within the first month. That's if you don't seek help, which would be the old way that the coronary care units 40 years ago, you know what they used to do? They would just sit a guy in a room and watch him. They would support him mechanically, but they weren't. There's no opening anything. You just watch him go through the natural process of infarcting the vessel, of infarcting the muscle. And survive have a much better prognosis if they can get there with a 28-day survival of more than 85%. The prognosis of anterior infarcts is worse as compared to inferior, and we talked about why that's the case. So should we pray? Yes. Will God answer us? I don't know. These are a few of the goals that we're all setting. First medical contact to the first ECG should be less than 10 minutes. That's if they're coming straight from our ER, but also if they're coming into the ER. But this is also true for you. So once they come in, they have chest pain, you don't want to dilly around figuring out is this a STEMI or not, because we just talked about how many people die and how fast they die. So for primary PCI, we have 90 minutes. That's our goal. 60 minutes if the patient presents with. Don't worry about this. Our whole goal is 90 minutes. From the first contact that you have that we've identified a STEMI to us opening the artery should not be more than 90 minutes. That's the gold standard. That's the best. They do the best when we do that. These are the indications for STEMI, for doing the PCI. I'm not going to go through that. These are the other things. You guys have heard of Mona. Are you paramedics or yeah?
Paramedics.
You're paramedics. So you guys know this Mona thing, morphine, oxygen, nitroglycerin, and aspirin. These are just add-on medicines to give. What symptoms, looking at the top three symptoms, is that an MI that is anterior or posterior or inferior? Which signs are we going to see those? Pallor, sweating, and tachycardia. Anterior wall MI or inferior? Which one has more muscle involved?
Inferior.
Anterior, right? The LAD involving. So those people can be in shock. They're white, they're pale, and they're tachycardic to try and compensate. Whereas if it's a bottom heart attack on the bottom, it can involve the vagal nerve and it can be bradycardic. And there's a clear sign that you can get some idea of where it is. These are some of the things that can happen during the heart attack that we talked about that can cause major problems. Arrhythmias, bradycardia. Have you guys seen anyone coming in bradycardic with an inferior wall MI? Or you had to give atropine or I don't know what you guys give. Do you guys usually give atropine in the field? Or dopamine? Okay. These are the late effects. We don't see this that much anymore. And you know what? These were the late effects of allowing a heart attack to evolve on its own and doing nothing about it, we would see more of this, that the septum would rupture, would become necrotic, and then it would actually poke a hole between the left and the right ventricle. You're in deep crap. You can muscle, the mitral valve is attached to muscles. If one of those goes and the mitral valve goes, you have wide open fluid going straight back into the lungs. We don't see it much because we're opening these arteries before everything dies. This would happen if the free wall, if all this area became necrotic and died, and it poked a hole, and you know the heart is held in a sac, all the blood would come out to here, fill the sac, and it would suffocate the heart. That's called tamponade. But we don't see it that much. This we see. In ventricular aneurysms, we still see it, but we don't see it because of us. We see it because they wait too long. Where's this STEMI? The name shouldn't be there, so that's my fault. Come on, guys, you've been doing this now for an hour. Good. Do we see anything in lead three that makes us a little unhappy? Good. So this is a real case, actually. So this is the left coronary system. We see that he does have some problems here. This is the LAD, this is the circumflex. We see that. So look here, one of the branches of the circumflex is tight, but it's not completely occluded. So that's not the culprit vessel. Let's see if I, how do I replay that again? Okay. You see this branch over here? It has a tight narrowing, but it's not the culprit. So what do we expect to see on the right if this is an inferior wall MI? Right? Isn't that what we anticipated seeing? That the right's completely blocked off at this point? So here's my contrast. This is that catheter going all the way up the aorta. This is the catheter coming to here. Contrast going into the coronary and also back flushing into the aorta. Okay, so that's completely occluded. Here we have a wire down this vessel now. And what is this? That's my balloon right at the area that was completely blocked off. Opening the balloon, and now let's see what we accomplish. That's the balloon going up. Come on, baby. Oh, wow. Yay. That's pretty cool, right? That's a pretty gratifying moment. And we've been able to open the artery. But we see that the vessel is still not perfect here. If you looked at it, we have an open vessel, but there's still like a 70% blockage there. There's a lot of schmutz. It's not stable. So now we're going to go back to that same area, and we're going to put a stent there. And it's like auto body work at this point. What's happened now? The balloon's open. The vessel's open. Is the patient still having a heart attack? No. Okay. Not by definition, no. Why? Because what did we say? Door to balloon time. Did the balloon go up? What's the good news after the balloon came down? Right? Heart attack not happening now. Maybe a little bit, but we've restored blood flow. That's the goal. That's what the word door to balloon time means. Balloon up, balloon comes down, heart attack, we've subsided the heart attack.
Is there a percentage that you're like, it's 100% and now we're at 30%?
Residual after we open it? Yeah. And that, your goal is to be less than 50% before the time of stents. Now you want it to almost be perfect. So what have I done here? This is the same. This is the same vessel. Now I've gone back and I took a balloon with a stent and I put a stent here. Now look at it. Cosmetically, it's like auto body work. It looks pretty good. Close to the way it probably looked before the guy ever had a heart attack. But this, let's come back to this idea here. Now, when we open this vessel, remember I said that most of the vessels that occlude are less than 50% narrowed before they go up? So that's kind of what you're seeing here. Before the guy had a plaque rupture, that's probably what that artery looked like. It wasn't completely occluded, and then a clot formed there. So now we put this stent here. It looks beautiful. We see two other things that we like here. What's this thing? What's that?
That's the one that perhaps you're talking about.
What's this black thing lying on this thing?
Oh, is that your wire?
Good. So that's my wire, and they're nice enough to let me be able to see it here so it doesn't go through the vessel. two things that we want to see. We want to see that the flow going through the vessel is very abrupt, that there's no huge delay. We see the blood stay here and everything just stays in the vessel like you took a photograph and it doesn't move. That's a bad news, because the part we're trying to get into is the muscle, which would be the city. So if you just see it lighting up and it doesn't go away and it doesn't go there abruptly, then the city's not getting any of its supplies. It has to get to the city. This is a nice train to the city, but it doesn't do more than that. It's got to get to the city. So when it doesn't get to the city, you didn't accomplish anything. And that's what we talk about, these things, Timmy scores. We want to see the flow being brisk, and we want to see, after we stop giving contrast, we want to see it flow away and not hang up in the artery. Second thing we want to see is this brown haze come over the muscle. That means that it's actually getting in the muscle and perfusing. So let's see if we see how fast the flow is again. Flow's good. Do you see a little of that brown haze coming over it? This is called blush. I don't know if you start to, I may have another picture of it, but that's something you want to see also. So here's just an inside view of what you're seeing, what the stent does. This is a ventriculogram. So your whole goal, you're real happy after you finish the whole case, you take a picture to see how the ventricle's moving. If it's not moving at all, that's not the end of the world, but it's not a sign that you, it's a sign that it's probably not going to go, that the guy came in delayed and more muscle died than not. So here's the ventricle. You see it squeezing in. Everything's coming in there. You see it all come into the midline? So things are alive. It'll pick up in time. It'll even get better. The heart has an ability to shut itself down so it doesn't die. It's called stunned myocardium. It turns down its metabolic mechanisms, and after 6 to 8 weeks, it can come back, and you'll see the muscle will normalize. However, if the person waited 12 hours, then you got a jelly donut full of jelly. That jelly, that's not getting better. I guess take-home message, everyone's different in the terms of the way we presented. We talked about women and men, how they're different in their presentation, not to be fooled or neglect doing an EKG when somebody presents with symptoms that are not necessarily typical of a heart attack. You don't have to be old. Have you guys seen this? I'm sure if you've been in this business for any time, you've seen young people come in with heart attacks. What's the youngest you guys have seen?
Frank that was sitting here was in his 30s when he got his, right? Late 30s?
HIPAA.
Yeah. Take me to jail.
But that's important to know, because the person can go neglected. And yeah, I agree. We've seen people in their 30s, many people in their 30s, unfortunately, now. And I think with the world in more turmoil and stress, these factors play some role in acute coronary syndromes. Women and men are equally susceptible. The speed with which you receive treatment can make the difference. That was all those pictures of showing you outcome. That's all we care about, is outcome. You don't give a damn about seeing that vessel open. That doesn't mean anything. What means something is if the patient walks out of the hospital and the patient still can have a meaningful life and isn't limited by his heart attack. Then you accomplish something. You didn't accomplish something just because you opened the damn vessel, right? That's not a significant, that's not a human being. That's just a piece of science you were watching. Importance of prevention. Here's where I think you can play a role, is when you're talking to people or anything. And because you guys become caregivers a lot of the time, right? You get there and somebody's asking you a lot of medical questions every time you're there. So the idea of, and this is even more important for stroke, which you got to keep in mind, I don't know how much you see, but when somebody tells you something, you should always tell people, especially with stroke, the brain is much less forgiving than the heart. There, they won't even touch you after 3 hours, no intervention. You just become paralyzed. So you should let people know that time is muscle, it's brain. If they have symptoms, they need to present immediately. Even if they're wrong, it doesn't matter. It's the same thing about the appendixes. You better take out a bunch of appendixes that are healthy and not miss one that's bad than be lax about it. That's it. Do you guys have any questions?
So we have our two hospitals in the city. They're non-STEMI centers. So
one is trying to become a STEMI center.
I think Downey is possibly right, yeah. So right now that requires us to go on a STEMI IFT, so we'll go to Downey or Kaiser and then we'll get transport out of there.
So that person gets more time, by the way, so that door-to-balloon time changes. If it's door out to the other, it extends out to 120. The goal time is 120 minutes to the balloon from the first medical contact.
Okay. And I know that what we've been trying to do, our goal is to... not transport somebody that doesn't end up in the cath lab, right? So, because we've had those.
Can you explain that to me?
Okay, so there was some frustration with some of our paramedics. We'll go out to Kaiser, let's say, and the only reason why we're there is for a high troponin level and not necessarily a STEMI on a 12 lead. And then they may or may not end up in the cath lab. So on our end, the study, what we're doing is if they ended up in the cath lab or not.
For STEMI or non-STEMI?
Either one.
Because
I think
it sounds, what you're describing would be a non-STEMI. Pretty much you're saying if you're coming and the only indication of a heart attack is a troponin, that's going to be a non-STEMI.
Yeah. And I think if for our terms and for LA County, what's
right.
considered, okay, a legitimate call to
another
facility is if they've gone to the cath lab.
Okay, so I would say the following thing. So let's divide again the STEMI and the non-STEMI.
Yeah.
All the STEMI should go and let us deal with the consequences, which is very frustrating for us. Your goal is to learn what a STEMI looks like, so you get more comfortable knowing it. We talked about reciprocal changes. We talked about symptoms. Everything is an amalgam of putting together in some German word that you learn in medicine called Gestalt, which means the whole put together of everything. Is it smelling like ischemia, like this German teacher I had where I trained? Can you smell it? Which is patient's pale, patient's weak, patient's giving this Levine sign of their hands over here, and it smells like it, and their EKG looks like it. That's probably it. Okay, so let's keep that in mind. I know that's kind of almost in the sense of racial profiling, because you're going to miss people, right?
Mm-hmm.
I agree with you. But STEMI should go. And now you're just learning what is a STEMI versus some cases where it's ambiguous. So we'd rather if you think it's ambiguous, that's different. But if it's real, send it, even if it doesn't go to the cath lab. The non-STEMI is a different situation. The non-STEMI, again, the situation will be if the patient, that they need urgently, you're saying they need a paramedic, means that somebody's making them go urgently somewhere.
Yeah, they're calling us to transport, correct.
Okay, so a lot of the times that you're seeing that are from which hospitals?
Downey and Kaiser.
Well,
I think it was
mostly Kaiser.
Mostly Kaiser.
Right,
every
so
on
let's
down.
Understand that. Downey has the ability to do cath. The same doctors, it's the exact same doctors that are running the STEMI center at St. Francis, were the exact same doctors at Downey. We just don't have a STEMI center there. So it'll be very seldom that you're going to see Downey send out a non-STEMI. Very seldom.
Okay.
Almost never. Kaiser doesn't have the ability to do it. Kaiser brings all of its patients to Sunset. That's where that's their mecca. That's where they do all the surgery. That's where they have all their interventional people. So their goal is if they're stable, they'll transfer them out to Sunset the next day. If they're unstable, what is unstable? Unstable is they're having active chest pain, they're having active dynamic ischemic EKG changes, they're hypotensive, hypoxic. These might be emergent cases where they need to go to a higher level of care closer than Downey Sunset, than Kaiser Sunset.
Yeah, we contract with Lakewood, so we end up going there.
Go to Lakewood. So, I think if there, you should ask that question: is the patient unstable? Is the patient having active chest pain? Is the patient hypoxic? If there's indicators the patient's unstable and they need a higher level of care immediately, it's warranted.
Okay.
But using as your, I understand what you're saying. Your standard is: did they go to the cath lab or not go to the cath lab?
Right.
I mean, I understand where you're coming from, but even half the STEMIs that you guys are sending, I'm not sending to the cath lab. They stay downstairs and we cancel it. More than half.
And I think that's why, for our medics, it'd be nice to know from a cardiologist's perspective, like what are your triggers on why they should go to a STEMI center or not?
Or upstairs.
Or because we'll go and sometimes this is just a high troponin level, and we have no idea if they're going to go to the cath lab or not.
Right. So
and
now
it's
you're
up
learning
to the cardiologist to kind of.
So I'm telling you more now. You learn more. You saw some EKGs. You saw some convincing EKGs. We're looking at the same damn thing. We're using the same criteria you just learned. Are there reciprocal changes? How profound are the ST elevations? What are the symptoms the patient's presenting with? Is he unstable and having unremitting chest pain in the setting of those EKG changes? Sometimes we'll see these EKG changes. The patient looks stable, looks fine. I'm not convinced I can do an ultrasound. We talked about why that ultrasound's useful, because in the cascade of ischemia, the wall should go down before the STs go up or before they have pain. So if the wall's banging, that's probably not a STEMI. That artery's not completely occluded because that wall would not be banging away.
Okay.
So we have the ability, one, to look at more things once they get there than you. But a lot of what we're looking at is just simply that stupid EKG. And the more you guys look at him now and the more you're seeing him, I guarantee you that you should make some predictions. That'll be the fun part for you. Make a prediction. Patient comes, you say, is this going to be real or not? We're sending him to the STEMI center. And you'll see, based on looking at those EKGs a little more carefully now, you'll be able to predict what I'm going to say when I see it. Oh, shit, that's 3 millimeters ST elevation with reciprocal changes. He's hypotensive and having chest pain. He's probably going. The other guy, you pick him up in the clinic, he's sitting there looking just like this. You have to transport him because we talked about this idea that you can't miss one because the outcome is so deadly. But if you're not convinced after you've seen the EKG and you see the thing, you can probably guess. Have a wager between you guys. You think this guy will end up in the cath lab? Immediately, if that's your question, immediately. And you'll begin to see that that's the way we're looking at it too. Does it fit? Is there still a question? Is there any way that I can discern this without going there? Remember, going there is not 100% innocent. Bad things can happen in the cath lab to patients. I've seen every one of them, unfortunately. Do you know some of the bad things that can happen? I can cause a stroke. I've done that 3 or 4 times in my career. Patient suddenly sitting there. My best was when I was working in New Jersey. And suddenly I told the guy to smile, and he's like this. And I said, close your eyes, and he closed one eye. And the lady goes, oh, he's just over-sedated. And this was just doing a diagnostic cath. I must have knocked something off into one of his head arteries. I go, screw you, this is a stroke. And we flew the guy off to Philadelphia, and he got thrombolytics, and he did okay. That's scary as hell. I mean, it's just a horrible feeling. Next thing that can happen, you can poke a hole in the artery. That's called a rupture or a perforation. If you perforate that artery and the blood gets into that sac and sucks and you can't get any blood flow because you're tamponading it off, they die. You can dissect the artery with that wire. It goes in, remember the artery is like an onion. You get that, suddenly that wire gets inside the layers of it and you're forcing it and then that layer falls down like a blanket over the artery. You completely stop the artery. What do you think that looks like on the EKG? It's a STEMI. It's not a clot. It's a piece of that vessel wall now completely occluding the vessel. But it's closed. Closed is closed. To the guys waiting for that blood supply, closed is closed. STEMI. So I've seen all of it. I've seen patients die. I've seen patients get shocked. So going there is not completely innocent. The benefit clearly outweighs the risk when it's the real thing. But going not always is not the answer. If you can prove that it's not that, you shouldn't go because there's risk. Another thing is we see patients, half the patients here for some reason, especially over there, their kidneys suck. Especially the ones that come in, their creatinine's 3. What do you think happens when I give them contrast? I worsen that situation. So if there's a way I can limit that, that's great. On the other hand, if they're having a STEMI and their creatinine's 3, I could give a shit. Because the thing they're going to die from is the heart attack, not going into renal failure. So I'm going to open it. It's a benefit-risk sort of thing. So if somebody doesn't go to the cath lab necessarily, understand that that this higher level of care may have modalities that allow them to look at it. But as I said, at Downey, you shouldn't see... The ones that we get that I've seen, the train wrecks that they want to send out to Lakewood or to us, those are generally STEMIs. They've all been pretty much the ones I've seen have all been STEMIs that they're not in a situation to take care of. Why are they not in a situation? It's not that they don't have them, they don't have somebody, a doctor who could do it. But they don't have a system in place that can productively get things done and has been certified by Los Angeles to do it in a timely fashion and is being observed and making sure that the feedback is. Here there's this whole mechanism going on. I don't know, she can tell you. There's a whole mechanism. She had a STEMI the other day. I saw a note between you and our STEMI director. Every time there's a STEMI, every main thing is to look at where could we have done better? How could we have made this better? She gets a letter back saying how fast you guys responded. If you guys didn't respond in time, then you gotta go over it. Going over it doesn't mean that you're a bad person. It just means how could we have done better? Because we know better, faster is better. And we are getting reviewed constantly too, both by LA and internally. That's part of the requirements of running a STEMI center. So Downey doesn't have all that in place. They're also not forced to abide by this idea of door to balloon time, and they're not being watched. So that's why they have to transfer the patient, because they can't get it all together so fast. If they become a STEMI center, they'll be forced to have people on call. Everybody's ready. They have to assemble in an immediate time. And that was the idea of creating STEMI centers, is that everything would move much more rapidly and that it would be organized in the way that it went. That you wouldn't send the patient, if the patient was closer to St. Francis than it was to Lakewood, then the closest STEMI receiving center should come to us. It shouldn't drive an extra 2 miles, because that 2 miles could be 10 minutes. And that's more muscle loss, and which translates into more death and more morbidity. Any other questions?
Yeah.
but you're important to us. You have no idea. I mean, the key to the whole thing is you guys, and keeping them alive till they get there. So I can't emphasize enough how important a role you play in this whole thing. Maybe you feel like a cab driver. You're not. I mean, you just saw that half of these idiots are not calling you. They're not calling you. And when they do call you, we have evidence. It's not ambiguous. Do they do better when they call you and come and get to the hospital faster? They do a hell of a lot better. So I want you to understand. We appreciate you. We really do. Okay?
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.